Zance lives in Madagascar, a huge island off the African coast. He dreams of being a sailor like his grandfather, Jinoro, and having his own sailboat, which is called a boutre here. To do so, he must ask the sacred crocodiles of Lake Anivorano, since only they possess the keys to his destiny. The journey is an opportunity for Zance to get to know the land of his ancestors. Along with his grandfather, he has to walk to the south of the island, beyond this rocky peak, to the village where Jinoro was born. The road will be long for both grandson and grandfather. They will have to cover 45 miles on foot through plains and forests. They arrive at the Rousset waterfall. Here, when someone is going to die, it's said that his life is at the top of the waterfall. For still unexplained reasons, lemurs took refuge in Madagascar when the island was separating from the African continent. Since these animals have nothing to fear from big cats or monkeys, simply because these species don't exist here, the area has become a sort of paradise for them. Lemurs are not afraid of humans, especially those who offer them bananas, a fruit they are mad about. Jinoro and Zance continue their journey through the forest. Jinoro explains to his grandson that he never fails, when he passes this cave, to ask his way from his ancestor. If he doesn't, something bad will happen. The spirits of the ancestors, the Razanas, survive in this way among the living, and they must never be forgotten. There's a legend that the former inhabitants of Lake Anivorano were changed into crocodiles because they refused an old man some water. They are, in a way, the ancestors of this area. Zance and Jinoro are almost there. They still have to go around the sacred lake to get to the village. To know if the sacred crocodiles of the lake are favorable to Zance's dream, Jinoro will make an offering of a zebu. If they accept the food, the youngster will know that the spirits of the ancestors have agreed to help him. Zance is impatient to know if the crocodiles will come out of the water. And they do. They finally come out and take the sacrificed zebu's meat. Considered to be sacred, the crocodiles of Lake Anivorano are respected by everyone. They never attack man. Zance is reassured now, since he knows that the Razanas will help him achieve his dream, and that one day, he will buy his own boutre and sail round the great island as Jinoro has done all his life.
Liana Kraye
The Zafirmaniry, who live in the highlands of Madagascar, are famous for their woodcrafting skills. Jean-Marie is in Ambustre with his sons, delivering the bowls he carved in the forest to Jean d'Arc, a local dealer. These objects, sought after by tourists, are used to store rice. Jean-Marie's youngest son, Solo, must now learn the art of carving these bowls. Jean-Marie selected a magnificent 150-year-old rosewood from which to carve his bowls. It's one of the most valuable trees in the Madagascan forest. The sculptors love working with this extremely hard wood. Jean-Marie is not hurting the forest by cutting down the tree. Quite the opposite. It will leave a window of light so that the younger trees have more room to grow. The bowl is not carved widthwise in the tree, but lengthwise. It takes a man working alone 2 days to clear a piece of the trunk. The closer it's cut to the ground, the wider the bowl. A troop of lemurs perched in the trees are intrigued by the sounds the men make. The Zafirmaniry don't hunt them. They believe that the spirits of their ancestors leap on the backs of these animals and jump from branch to branch with them. Solo must now use his axe to carve the curve of the bowl. It's a difficult step. A misplaced blow and the bowl will have to be smaller, and therefore sell for a much lower price. The work is exhausting. Solo lets his older brother, Victor, take over. Jean-Marie is a talkative father. He explains to his sons that he's teaching them things that can't be learned at school and can't be bought with money. It's a skill from their ancestors, who have transmitted the art of Zafirmaniry wood carving. It takes one man 3 weeks, working morning to night, to create a bowl from the heart of the tree. Night comes early in the forest, and the men continue carving by the light of the fire and candles. They eat the same meal every day, rice cooked in water and seasoned with hot peppers. Solo uses his chisel to carve the inside of the bowl. His father is reassured. His son has a steady hand. Solo is now tackling the final difficult step in his apprenticeship. He must carve the handles of the bowl from the block. The large rosewood was transformed into several bowls. With the remaining wood, Jean-Marie and his sons also fashioned covers, honey pots, and statuettes. Once again, Jean-Marie is proud of his son. Solo is now able to earn a living and perpetuate the art of their ancestors, which he may one day transmit to his own children. It takes 2 days to walk over difficult paths to the village, where Jean-Marie and his sons will deliver their bowls, each of which weighs 35 to 40 kilograms. These magnificent bowls weigh heavily on the shoulders of these unknown artists who live in the heart of the Malgache forest.